As always, we'll start with an overview of the recent SpaceX Starship activities at Boca Chica. And while SpaceX is working on the most important next-generation space vehicle, the national team is busy working on the last-generation space vehicle. They delivered a mock-up of their human lander for the Artemis program to NASA. So how does this moon lander compare to Starship?
In other news, Tory Bruno is quickly becoming the new Rogatin of the spaceflight industry by mocking reusable rockets as costly and inefficient. SpaceX answers by setting up a new reusability record with one of their Falcon 9 boosters during the latest Starlink mission. Then we also have an update on the Chinese reusable rocket. A lot to talk about, so stay tuned.
So at Boca Chica, all attention is now on SN6, and things are going well, as we could yesterday already see the first static fire test of that prototype. Already on the 18th of August, the Raptor engine with serial number 29 had been installed on that prototype. Initially, the static fire was planned for today, however, since storms and rainfall are expected for this week, they had been pulled forward with the primary road closure date already yesterday on Sunday. Which then indeed was perfect, as the static fire test had been successful. Now, of course, it remains to be seen how the weather will affect the test schedule for the upcoming days, but we probably will see a few further static fire tests before the next hop attempt, which could be as early as this week on Friday, if everything goes well, according to current road closure dates, with backup dates this week on Saturday and Sunday. SN5, meanwhile, is still in the mid-bay together with SN8, which is continuing to grow. SN8 is the first prototype based on the new 304L steel alloy. Last time we mistakenly said SN6, for which we apologize. Thus, the real fun will start when SN8 is fully assembled. The high bay is meanwhile continuing to rise towards its impressive final height of around 80 meters. Construction on SN9 has begun meanwhile. In these, as always, amazing shots from Mary aka Boca Chica Gal, we can see the SN9 forward dome. A new mount has meanwhile been installed onto the new launch pad B. Yes, another Starship launch pad is also being built. And the first pillar of the Super Heavy launch pad has been put in place. Of course, the coolest thing will be to have multiple flight-ready Starship prototypes, which has never before been the case, and see them hop in close succession to each other.
So while Elon is building the most important, disruptive and transformative space vehicle of humanity, which will reduce the costs of spaceflight by factors of thousands, nay, even tens of thousands, thus enabling us to build colonies on the Moon, Mars, hell, one day even on Callisto or Titan, maybe even floating cloud cities on Venus. What are the competitors doing meanwhile? Also building rockets of a similar transformative scale? Please, of course not. Instead, they're just trying to repeat Apollo. That's right, half a century after Apollo, the best they came up with was a bigger version of the Apollo moon lander, but now more complicated, of course, so that more inefficient companies can work on it, with three elements instead of two. Of course, we are talking about the national team's moon lander. Their fancy moon lander consists of three stages: a transfer stage built by Northrop Grumman, a descent stage built by Blue Origin, with Draper leading the descent stage's guiding and avionics, and lastly, an ascent stage built by Lockheed. And this national team's moon lander only costs a relaxed $18.4 billion, which of course seems totally justified. A full-scale engineering mock-up of this lander with the descent and the ascent stages has now been delivered to NASA's Johnson Space Center. Immediately, we can see that the lander is quite a lot taller than Apollo LEM, and consequently also has a roomier interior. Blue Origin promptly released a shiny video, link in the description, to praise this moon lander as a giant update from the Apollo LEM. Don't get us wrong here. We absolutely support getting back to the moon with NASA's Artemis program. It's just a bit telling though, that the most unspectacular approach, basically just a bigger and slightly updated version of the Apollo LEM, gets the most recognition from NASA. It's just a bit too telling, you know. Especially when the companies in the national team, let's say, well, are a lot nearer to Congress than SpaceX or Dynetics. By the way, SpaceX and Dynetics are the other two contenders to build moon landers as part of the human landing systems for NASA's Artemis mission. The national team, of course, got the biggest share from NASA with $579 million. Dynetics, which in our opinion has a much more innovative and better moon lander, only got less than half that with $253 million. And please consider subscribing to our channel, because first, it's completely free. And second, you will tremendously help us to continue talking about space politics openly and exposing those corrupt legacy space companies.
Back to the Human Landing Systems Award, SpaceX is of course last with $135 million. So basically, in short, the more innovative your moon lander is, the less money you get. That is certainly not how innovation should be rewarded. Dynetics moon lander, for example, looks not only much roomier than the national team's, but it also doesn't have this complicated multi-stage architecture. Plus, it also comes with large solar panels. Thus, this moon lander would allow for much longer stays on the surface than with the national team lander, possibly even up to 2 weeks. And of course, we don't even have to talk about the moon version of Starship, do we? We all know how brutally superior Starship is compared to the national team lander. I think this picture here says it best. It says it better than 1,000 words could. How a Starship compares to the national team lander, which we like to call the lobby lander. Because we all know that lobbying really does seem to pay off, at least short term. Long term, even lobbying won't save these companies once Starship is ready. And $18 billion for this lander? Come on! How many Starships could we have for that money? Probably over 100, complete with a moon base. Also, we shouldn't forget that for the 2024 Artemis moon landing, NASA would need the final approval from the Senate later this year. The human landing systems necessary for Artemis foresee $3.3 billion for the moon lander. Currently, however, NASA only gets around $600 million. Without this approval from the Senate, it looks bad anyways for an Artemis moon landing in 2024. And please remember that Starship will land on the moon, with or without NASA. Because SpaceX will be de facto independent from NASA, with their giant funds thanks to Starlink. But to be fair, we also want to say this. Should the national team really have the first moon lander to return to the moon in 2024, we will still cheer like crazy, open 5 bottles of champagne, and have an insane moon party, because seeing astronauts return to the moon will deserve cheering, even if it should be in this unspectacular lander here.
Last week, we already talked about the fight between SpaceX and ULA for the military contracts. Elon ranted about ULA relying on non-reusable rockets and still getting the major share of the military launch contracts. Of course, as a viewer of this channel, you know that good old lobbying is the key to success here. But now Tory Bruno, the CEO of ULA, had to fire back towards Elon. He said on Reddit, link in the description, that reusable rockets only make financial sense if you have at least 10 reuses per rocket. He claimed that there's so much added costs for the whole logistics for capturing and refurbishing the rocket, which drives up the price of reusable rockets a lot. Well, funny, a Falcon 9 rocket costs $62 million per launch for a new booster, and $50 million with a reused one. At least half of that is pure profit margin. On the other hand, ULA's upcoming Vulcan Centaur rocket will cost approximately $30 to $40 million per rocket to build, and $82 to $200 million per launch. So only building the Vulcan rocket is almost as much as an entire Falcon 9 launch, which includes all costs, plus of course the profit margin. How exactly Tory Bruno arrived at the conclusion that 10 is the magic number, we don't know. Actually, we do know exactly. ULA is completely incapable of building reusable rockets. So of course, they have to find an excuse. So if you're not capable of doing something, you just pretend that you actually don't want that. Classic human psychology 101. For example, you secretly want to be rich, but are incapable of achieving it. And then you of course say, but actually I don't want to be rich. That would totally corrupt my character. Tory Bruno is doing the same here. He pretends that there are economical reasons for ULA not to build reusable rockets, which of course is a total lie. The best they can do is the Vulcan Centaur, where only the engines will be reused. The rest of the launch system is thrown away every time. Nice try, Tory, nice try. It seems that you really want to become the next Rogozin of the spaceflight industry.
And as if to answer Tory Bruno, SpaceX achieved an impressive reusability milestone, reusing a Falcon 9 booster for the sixth time on the last Starlink mission on the 18th of August. And we are very sure that SpaceX saved a lot of money by reusing this rocket six times, huh, Tory? But the funny thing is that the Chinese seem to understand that reusable rockets make sense. And there are a few Chinese companies working on reusable rockets. We wonder why this could be if it doesn't make any financial sense. Anyways, the most promising of these companies is LinkSpace. They now completed the third successful hop test of their test version for their upcoming line of rockets called New Line. This hop test, by the way, went 300 meters high.
We already talked in this video here about the current status of the Chinese reusable rockets and even speculated if they could actually copy Starship. Link in the description. Now with this hop test complete, LinkSpace will next try to perform suborbital test flights, and their goal is to build a new Line 1 in at least 75% reusable rocket with a 200 kg payload capacity to LEO and more than 10 launches per booster. So while it won't be anywhere near Falcon 9's capability, it's still interesting to see that China is pursuing reusable rockets. We are very curious where this path will lead them.
And talking about Chinese reusable rocket companies, could they maybe even copy Starship? We talked about this idea in that video here.
So thanks for watching the JI Space Report, and I would say, on to the future. Test, test, famous test. Then we also have some news on the Chinese. Okay, actually I could read it. The national team, what a... How did they come up with this embarrassing name?